Remind everyone that this meeting is being broadcast and recorded, and the recordings will be available on public access cable as well as YouTube. And we have a quorum at 7 o'clock, so I'll call our meeting to order. Our primary purpose for this evening is to hear the town manager's five-year financial forecast. But before we begin, I would just ask if there's any public comment. And I, yes, Ms. Combs.
I just want to remind everybody once again that A Date with Judy is being produced at Lunenburg High School. The show starts tomorrow evening at 7 o'clock. Tickets are $10 for adults. Seniors and students are $7. The doors open at 6:30. It's a phenomenal production, and it's also playing on Saturday. I think we had a preview or a matinee show for the seniors, a free matinee for the seniors today, and appreciate everybody come out. But do come out and enjoy it. Some great talent at Lunenburg High School. So come join us and enjoy a show.
That's
it's
great.
It's much less expensive than Broadway, I assure you.
Thank you. Any other public comment before we begin? I will allow for public comment or questions as we go through the presentation. Seeing none, I do have some information to share. There is an information meeting of the Lunenburg Planning Board on December 14th, 2015 at 6:35 p.m. here at Town Hall to hear and discuss a site plan review under Section 8.4 of the Protective Bylaw of the Town of Lunenburg. The application is for a proposed 45,000 square foot office and maintenance facility with associated driveways, parking, grading, and utilities at 357 Electric Avenue, MAP 93, Parcel 56, Lunenburg, Mass. Applicant is Unitil, Fitchburg Gas and Electric Light Company, 6 Liberty Lane, West Hampton, New Hampshire. Property owner is Joseph Russo, 164 Dale Avenue in Leominster. And the application and plans are available for viewing in the planning office. And I do have the latest edition of the Beacon. Any other communications from the committee? Okay. So I'd like to introduce Town Manager Carrie LaFleur, and she's going to present the five-year financial forecast.
Okay, thank you and good evening. There are several documents that are handouts this evening. They are at the back of the room if anybody came in and you didn't pick one up. There's a copy of the full financial forecast, a copy of the presentation, and a copy of a news article that was just released today through the MMA that we might mention maybe later on in the meeting. Before we get started, I just wanted to let everybody know that all of this information is also on the website. I have the website up here, the front page of the website, under news and announcements, the information about the financial forecast. So if anybody is watching at home and they would like to follow along, you can do that. And with that, I will start the presentation. As you know, this is my favorite time of the year, aside from the cold. I love working on the budget and talking about the budget, and I hope all of you enjoy it as much as I do. So the financial forecast is really the kickoff of the budget process. It's something that we do every year, and I know for those of you who have been to this presentation for a number of years, a lot of this is review, but there's always somebody new listening, so I'd like to just take a few minutes to talk about why we forecast before we get into the document itself. So we do this because it's part of best practices. It's something that's required by the charter under Section 4-2S. And we do it because our bond rating agencies look favorably upon communities that forecast. And as you know, the town of Lunenburg has a AA-plus bond rating. It's the second highest bond rating. Our bond rating has increased significantly over the last couple of years. And I'd like to think that one of the reasons it has is because we go through this forecasting process. So just so everybody understands the difference between forecasting and budgeting. Forecasting provides a long-term and comprehensive perspective on service deliveries, and in order to do this, we put together, or we combine, known information and assumptions, versus a budget, which is a specific plan detailing service delivery for the coming fiscal year. There are several goals of forecasting, including gaining a long-term perspective, determining whether or not there are fiscal problems on the horizon, giving you the opportunity to plan for change. We do this in advance of the budget, so it gives us an opportunity to see what we may expect as we go through the budgeting process. And it also reinforces the need for long-range considerations during the annual budgeting process. So, you know, it's difficult when we're working on the budget and all of a sudden we have some additional money that becomes available. Sometimes, you know, I think the worst time to solve a problem is when you're in the middle of it. The best time is when you're removed from it and maybe you're not so emotional about it. You're not responding to maybe the biggest stimulus that you're receiving at the time. So this gives us an opportunity before we start the budget process, before we start hearing from all of the departments, before we start hearing about all of the needs, kind of to look at what we may expect as we go through the process. So then there are a few key concepts. The first being that this is just a set of projections. There are many assumptions that go into this, and any of those assumptions can change. So this is a forecast based on these set of assumptions that we'll talk about. There's an opportunity for the Finance Committee, the Board of Selectmen, to talk about this further, potentially change some of the assumptions and see what that looks like. The nice thing is that once you develop the model, it's very easy to change the assumptions. And then lastly, if your forecast shows a shortfall, it does imply that you're going to do something about that. You're going to take action to balance the budget, either by raising revenues, reducing expenses, or adjusting service levels. So then there are a handful of tools and guides that we use to put the forecast together. Mass General Law, Town Bylaws, Generally Accepted Standards, our own internal financial policies, an analysis of trends, and then our contractual obligations, our debt service schedules, union contracts, salary administration plan, and then finally the assumptions that we use to put the forecast together. So in terms of the tools, I'll talk about each of them or groups of them just briefly. For Mass General Law, we have laws that govern labor, employee benefits, and in some cases require delivery of certain services. We have town bylaws that require delivery of certain services, and even the enforcement of bylaws has a financial impact. And then we have accounting standards, generally accepted accounting practices, and the Government Accounting Standards Board that issues standards that we have to follow. We are impacted by minimum manning standards and other types of generally accepted standards. We have other things like net school spending and the requirement of the library to spend a certain amount in order to receive state aid that we have to take into account. And then I'd like to also note that there are some services that really don't have any mandates associated with them. But there are things that we value here in the community, and those have to be taken into account as well. There has to be a balance between all of the services that we provide, because we have different constituencies in town that need certain services, and we have to take those into account as well. And then we have financial policies. The Finance Committee drafted financial policies and sent them to the Board of Selectmen for approval, and they were approved last fall. And they address stabilization fund and general reserve accounts, free cash, capital projects and purchases, and borrowing and debt burden. And we have to take these financial policies into consideration. For instance, we have a financial policy that requires us to have 5% of our operating budget in the stabilization fund. So that is a requirement that needs to be built into both the forecast and the annual budget. And we look at trends and contractual obligations. I do have a report called the Financial Trend Monitoring Report that I do in the background. A number of years ago, I presented that with the financial forecast, and I'm not sure who may have been here, but that made for a really long presentation. So that's something that I do in the background, and it helps me put the forecast together. And that really is looking at the last 5 to 10 years worth of data in certain areas and looking at those trends, and that helps project the trend going forward. Again, union contracts, we have to take those into account, and then existing debt service schedules. So we use all of this data to make assumptions about revenues and expenditures, about revenues, about service levels, and the cost of services. And in the financial forecast document, the larger document, there is a one-page detail of all of the revenue and expenditure assumptions. I'm not going to go through that line by line. That's there for your reference. We'll point out most of it through the presentation, but there may be a few things that I skip over, and at the end, please feel free to ask questions. So what I did with the forecast this year, and I've done it in the past, is I forecasted what I call existing conditions, and then I have another section that is above level recommendations is what I called it. So first, if you look at existing conditions, in fiscal 17, I'm projecting a deficit of $410,132. And then, as I've done in the past, I've also put together target budgets because I think it really has helped all of the departments to have a target to work towards as they put their annual budget recommendation together. But if you look at the 4 out years, again, existing conditions in fiscal 18, projecting a deficit of $412,000, and going up to fiscal 2020 to $1.15 million. So when I first looked at this, I thought, well, there must be an error in the calculation, because how do you have a $400,000 deficit in 1 year and a $400,000 deficit in the next year? But what I did note is that the reason the deficit seems lower in fiscal 18 than what you might expect is because we have a decrease in debt service of $243,737, almost $153,000 of which is non-exempt debt service. So under this model, that excess capacity within the budget for debt service is just eaten up by additional expenses. So we've talked in the past about setting that aside for some sort of capital, which I will recommend again. But in this part of the model, it's just assuming, I didn't plug that, so that's why it looks lower in fiscal 18. And then you see a big jump in fiscal 2020. Oh, I got two 2020s. The second 2020 is actually 2021. There's another jump there because I've increased the capital budget from $600,000 to $750,000. And I increased it in 20 and 21. Obviously, we could move that closer to present and we'd have a bigger deficit, or we could take that out. I put it in there because anybody who follows the capital budgeting process, you know what a struggle it is each year to come up with a budget or to identify the highest priority needs within the constraints that we have. So I think we need to strongly consider increasing our capital budget, and I've put it in there in 2020 going forward. So then I mentioned some above level service recommendations. Obviously, every department could submit requests that they would like. The reality is, it's very difficult for us to fund even the highest priority above level recommendations. So what I've done is I've pulled out what I think are the highest of the priorities based on what has been submitted in previous years. So again, the departments haven't started their budget process, so there may be something that as they submit their budgets that might pop up as a need that's not identified here. These are in no particular, well, they are in a particular order, and the particular order is the way they appear in the budget based on our accounting system. So first, the police department, 3 patrol officers, and I won't go through all the numbers, we'll just talk about what the items are. In the fire department, 24/7 ambulance coverage using per diem staff. Lunenburg Public Schools, the superintendent's recommendation, and when I get to what's included for Lunenburg Public Schools, I'll explain this further, but I split the request from the superintendent into existing conditions and above level, and that's where that comes from. In DPW, 1 additional laborer/heavy equipment operator position. Right now we have 5. It makes all the sense in the world to have 6, so we can have 2-3 person crews with 1 supervisor. We would be able to accomplish a lot of work that we have in backlog. The pavement management program is listed in here because that's something that is not adequately funded. Stormwater management projects, this number really is a plug. We have not really started to identify what our needs are in terms of stormwater management, but they're greater than the $40,000 that we have in the budget. And I put 200, it probably could be anything from 200 to 2 million based on what I've been hearing. And then finally, unclassified employee benefits, and that would be for the 3 patrol officers and the 1 DPW laborer that's listed here. Okay, I need to just take a drink for a minute. So next, revenue assumptions. We have 4 categories of revenue: property tax, state aid, local receipts, and available funds. In terms of forecasting property tax, it's a pretty easy thing to do. We take the prior year base, increase it by 2.5%, and then we add in new growth. And so for fiscal 17, I've added in $275,000. Our new growth in fiscal 16 was very strong at 320 or 360. I'd have to go back and double check. In fiscal 17, we expect to have Building 4 at Tri-Town Landing on the tax rolls, fully on the tax rolls, and that one building itself is $50,000. So we are starting to see an increase in new growth, so that is good news. And then we add in any voter-approved exempt tax. We will see a slight decrease right now in fiscal 17, but that will change because we will be doing an additional bond issuance in late January, early February for the school project, probably in the neighborhood of about $5 million. So we will need to add that. The impact of that project is tracking very close to the original information that was presented to the voters at town meeting in, well, almost 2 years ago now. So that is very good news. Then in terms of state aid, the one thing that is very difficult this early in the process is to say much about state aid, because the state's budgeting process really doesn't start until the governor issues his budget, which is at the end of January. What the state does is there is a joint legislative committee, a consensus revenue committee. They have a hearing in December. I believe it is December 16th. And at that time, the legislative committee receives input from all of the different state agencies that are involved in projecting revenues. And so that forms the initial basis for developing the state's fiscal 17 budget. At this point, I'm just assuming a 2% increase in all of the state aid accounts, except for veterans benefits. We should see a pretty significant increase in veterans benefits because we receive reimbursement of 75% of the prior year's expenditure. So we should see an increase there. I think I left out a copy of a news article that is currently running on Mass Municipal Association. The Mass Taxpayers Association completed a study, and they've talked about revenues statewide and then local receipts in the aggregate. So there's some very good information in there, but that's really the only thing that's out right now on state aid. And what it's saying is basically we shouldn't be, we're kind of in this modest growth period, so we shouldn't be expecting to receive any big increases in state aid. So one thing I wanted to mention is the 40S, the smart growth revenue, the additional education aid that we receive as a result of having a smart growth zoning district. I'm not going to go through all of this. Most of you have been following the budget process and you're familiar with what the this aid is, but it's some additional education aid that we receive based on the enrollment of students that live in the smart growth district. So one thing that is tricky is, you know, how we account for this going forward. So we first received funding in fiscal 15. We received $183,618. Now we had applied for funding in fiscal 14, and I don't think we received anything. I'm not even sure we received acknowledgement that we applied. The state also didn't fund it. So maybe there was no obligation to acknowledge something that wasn't funded. But we did apply in 15, and you apply in September because they're looking at the expenses, educational expenses, and the revenue you receive for the prior year. So you file in September, and by filing, you just submit data to them. There is a formula that they use that we haven't seen. We haven't had access to it. We've asked for it. We haven't received it. So it's hard for us to estimate what we would expect to receive. And in fiscal 15, we also didn't know what the timetable was. I don't think we even knew if we would get anything because we didn't know how they were calculating it. But we did receive something, but we received it late, and we didn't receive it in time to do anything with it, to have a town meeting to appropriate it. And it is a revenue that needs to be appropriated. And so what happened was we ended up with having excess levy capacity in fiscal 15 of about $200,000. So coming into 16, we know what the process is, we know what the timetable is, and even on the estimated cherry sheets, we were identified as receiving some Chapter 40S funding, so that was good. The way it happened this year, and we did have a special town meeting, so we were able to take that into account. So I think I have a fair level of comfort that we can use this as a revenue in fiscal 17, but you'll see I haven't included it in each year of the forecast. And I actually didn't even include it in the fiscal 17 forecast, but I did in the target. And I went back and forth about should I put it both places, but honestly, if I didn't have to count it, I wouldn't. But I think when I'm developing the targets, it's important to be very diligent, and so I'm counting it because we've received it 2 years in a row, and there was a little bit of a threat to it this year, but we got our legislative delegation really on the case, and they were able to do good work for us in this respect. But we only received just under $167,000, and the state told us, based on full funding of that line item, we should have received $238,513. So that was a disappointment. But the state didn't fully fund it. There are only two communities that participate or receive this funding, and so it's not the highest priority in the state house. I have included $150,000 in the target budget, and I think that's safe, assuming there's no huge decrease in enrollment. So in terms of local receipts, an overall projected increase of 3.59% or $96,730. $13,000 of that is coming from solar net metering credits. We've had a full year of that project, our Chase Road project, and we have a good idea, certainly a better idea than we did a year ago on what we should receive. So the total revenue from that project is $120,000, an increase of $13,000 over what we included in the budget last year. Motor vehicle excise tax, our collections have always been strong. I'm projecting an increase of $36,750. All the other categories at an increase of 2% besides meals tax, which is projected at an increase of 2.5%. I put a note on the bottom that we've not yet projected any increase in fees based on the updated traffic rules and orders, which I'm hoping will take up, the Board of Selectmen will take up in January, February at the latest, but at least have it in place, firmly in place for the beginning of the fiscal year. And we should see an increase in local receipts as a result of changing the fees and fines under the traffic rules and orders. And then our last revenue category is available funds. Right now I'm projecting an overall decrease in this category, but it's very close to last year, and really the only difference is I haven't included anything for prior year unexpended articles. If you follow the capital budgeting process, you know that part of their process is to look back at capital articles that have been approved, and if the project is closed out or the item has been purchased and there's any additional funding, we kind of scoop all of that up and then reappropriate it as part of the capital budget process as well. But it's a little too early to do that, so I haven't included anything in there. In past years, we've really had anything from $20,000 maybe to $50,000. So it's certainly helpful to the budget. I am projecting that we appropriate free cash in the amount of $250,000. The first $78,060 would be to deposit into the stabilization fund to maintain the 5% balance, and then the difference to offset capital. And that would leave us with the remaining balance of $13,188. There's no magic to that. I picked 250 rather than planning to expend the full amount. And obviously we have to pay the stabilization fund first. There is no draw on the stabilization fund throughout the life of this forecast. So in total, the new revenue for fiscal 17 under the target budget is $861,920. Under the forecast budget, under the target budget, it's increased by $150,000 to $1,011,920. Before I move to expenditures, I'm happy to pause to take questions on revenue.
Just to be clear about the difference between the forecast and the target, it's only the 40S funds. Is that correct? That's the only difference between forecasted revenues and target revenues?
Yes.
And Carrie, could you comment on the basis for your assumption of 2%? You've got 2% as the assumption of the growth in state aid. You also have 2% in the other local receipts. Mm-hmm. What's the basis for that, and what's the level of risk that it might be higher or lower than that?
So when I went back and looked at state aid over the last 5 years or so, the average increase was about 2.2%. We have seen higher increases in Chapter 70, but not significantly. Maybe it was slightly higher than that. So I thought 2% seemed like it was conservative enough. Aside from the darkest years, we've never received a decrease in state aid. I mean, obviously we had back in, we've never started the year with a decrease in state aid. We've received some decreases in state aid throughout the year. But state revenues are growing. If you look at that article that I submitted, I think they say 3.8% has been the average. I looked at that really quick before the meeting. So I think two is good. When the governor's budget comes out at the end of January, there might be opportunity to increase it. What we find is we usually end up doing a little better than what the governor provides to us in his budget. So that we can look at that again in January, at the end of January. For local receipts, local receipts are a lot more difficult to project. They can be all over the place. I honestly think they might be a little low. I had a long conversation with our building commissioner today, and he was telling me how busy he's been because there are so many people doing projects on their homes. And I mentioned to him, I know just in my neighborhood I've got three people that they're replacing their roofs. And it seems like it's been a number of years before you have seen people doing this type of work. So I think we might be a little low in our building permits. But it's difficult this far removed to come up with anything more significant than 2.5%.
Right. Thank you.
Any other questions before I move on? So just generally talking about expenditure assumptions related to service levels, we, through the document, we adhere to adopted financial policies, one of which is making a deposit to the stabilization fund to maintain the required balance. We honor all contractual obligations, such as debt service schedules and union contracts. This document assumes the same level of service except where it's noted otherwise. It assumes a 2-3% increase in most services and commodities unless noted otherwise. Utility costs, which we've seen significant increase over the last couple of years, they're projected in accordance with the contracts that we have. For municipal buildings, we have a longer-term contract for electric supply and gas supply than you do through the municipal electric aggregation plan. So it's easier for us to project what those costs will be. And I did make a note that I've not yet included any credit for the proposed NextAmp project. The Board of Selectmen at its meeting next week will take up the net metering agreement relative to that project, and we talked about that at our special town meeting. And I expect that that project will result in a $20,000 to $25,000 credit for utility costs for fiscal 17, which is not yet included in the forecast here. It assumes a 9% increase in retirement assessment. That will be confirmed at the annual meeting in January. I don't expect it to be anything other than 9% because they do a valuation of their system every other year, and they did one last year. And so last year they told us to expect 2 years of a 9% increase. Health insurance right now I'm projecting at 7%. I'll know more in February. Hopefully it won't be that high. But as you know, we had a couple of good years, and the current year was not as good as prior years, and I just don't have any basis to project anything other than what the medical trend is, not necessarily Lunenburg's trend, but what the overall medical trend is. One potential impact under the Affordable Care Act that we will have to take into account is the Cadillac tax. And this is something that you will be hearing me talk about when I'm more versed in the Cadillac tax. But this is a tax that is expected to affect municipalities in a pretty large way. I'm not sure, based on what I'm hearing, that we're going to be impacted, but because our overall costs for the plans that we offer is much less than what you might find in other communities. And that might be hard to believe because our overall cost per plan is significant, but it's less than what others are seeing. But the Cadillac tax is basically, it's a tax on high-value plans. So I want to say that $16,000 is the amount, but I'm not 100% sure. But say it's $16,000. If an employer offers a plan that the total cost per plan is $16,000 or more, there is a tax on the employer under the Affordable Care Act. And one thing that I have heard is that it is the plan plus any cafeteria benefits plan that the town offers, which seems odd to me because we offer an uninsured medical plan, but it's 100% employee contribution. So I'm not sure how or why that gets added in, but that's something that we will need to keep in mind as the Board of Selectmen negotiates the next public employee committee or next health insurance agreement with the public employee committee, which will come up in fiscal 17, and so more to follow on that. So this here is a summary of the expenditures by category in the forecast for 17 and the target budget for 17. And keep in mind, these are categories. So the first says education. That's Lunenburg Public Schools plus Montitech. Public Works, one department. Public Safety, that's police, fire, and dispatch. So I won't go through in detail in this chart because we will in the following slides, But this is just to give you an idea of the forecast and the target budget. And then the percentage, the column, the percents, that's the percentage of the total increase in the budget. So first, for schools, and this is Lunenburg Public Schools, not Monty Tech. The superintendent's initial request to be included in the forecast was 7%. That is a $1.2 million increase over the current fiscal year. 4.5% of that, or $788,179, I identified as existing conditions and included it in this portion of the forecast. And these existing conditions meet existing contractual obligations. There's a conversion of a position in district administration for the opening of the new middle school, high school. Right now, the school operates in three buildings with three principals. Even though the middle school, high school is one building, it has two wings that are distinct, and there will be a principal in each of those wings. No net increase in district administration, but a change in positions to accommodate that. A special education teacher at the primary school, six long-term sub-paraprofessionals, and a nurse at Turkey Hill Middle School, all to avoid out-of-district placement for special education. This is something I've talked to the superintendent. We've had some probably pretty long conversations about this because I have a particular interest in special education. I'm not a special educator, school administrator, but am a parent of a young man who went through special education, have family members who have benefited through special education. So I think the superintendent's ability to create programs within the district is really tremendously beneficial to the students and families, rather than sending them out of district with a whole host of issues, traveling, the transportation, and increased costs. So I think where we've been able to have these programs in-house has just been very beneficial. And then also increased health insurance costs. That's something that the school has to work with as well. And then the above level recommendations, that's 2.5% of that 7% increase. And these are to address increased enrollment. A teacher in grade 3, reinstating a part-time PE position, a technology teaching and technology support position, restoring one custodial position, and then some additional IT support. I believe it's one FTE requested by the IT department. Right now we have 2.75 FTEs for IT across the town throughout all departments, and this is an increase of one additional position. Next, public safety. The overall increase under the forecast for fiscal 17 is just under $49,000. This assumes the same level of service with some additional funding for overtime and lockup. There is a collective bargain. The collective bargaining agreement is up for negotiation. It expires at the end of this fiscal year. So there's no projection within the department budget to settle that contract, but there is funding set aside in the salary reserve. So this popped out as lower than what I would have expected, but it's because there's no increased personnel costs in here. Radio watch dispatch, the projected decrease, or the projection is a decrease of $15,100. Same level of service, $6,000 additional for the desk officer. The position is not necessarily one person, but the coverage of desk officer. So right now we cover that Monday to Friday, 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. There are times throughout the year that we need to go something outside of 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. So this would provide some flexibility. You know, when we're in a permitting season, or if we have poor conditions in the winter, we have outages, we need to have somebody at that desk outside of Monday to Friday, 7 a.m. to 7 p.m., this provides some flexibility. But what we will see in fiscal 17, and it will continue in fiscal 18, is a decrease in our regional dispatch district assessment. And we will see the decrease because we will be taking on a fifth and sixth member. A fifth member, the town of Bolton, will come on board for July 1st of 16, and the town of Berlin will come on board July 1st of 17. So the actual decrease in assessment with the town of Bolton coming on is $21,100. But I've taken six of that and reallocated it to the desk position. And then when Berlin comes on in fiscal 18, we will see a decrease of $12,600. That will be the lowest point for that assessment. At that point, we will be at capacity for the existing staff that we have and the structure, the operations itself. Any additional members to the regional dispatch district would require additional space, additional equipment, and additional personnel. So at this point, we don't have any plans to grow beyond that, you know, without doing a much larger study. But you know, it's nice to see that we will receive the same level of service at a reduced cost, and we have both chiefs here. I'm sure that they could provide some comment, but from my perspective, after the initial hiccups, it's really been very beneficial. We're working with regional dispatch. They're helping us out with animal control, with dispatching animal control. They are helping us out with reinstating our Are You Okay? Program, which checks on homebound persons in the community. So they've been very receptive to taking on some what I think people would see as additional responsibilities. And then within the fire department, an increase of $14,000, same service level, 7 days a week, 7 a.m. to 7 p.m., and we're on call, our call department after that. We have a collective bargaining agreement with the firefighters union that expired at the end of fiscal 14 that we have been in negotiations on. And again, funding for that is not in the department budget, but it's within the salary reserve account. And I mentioned previously the above level recommendation for additional ambulance coverage at a cost of $192,000. In public works, I previously mentioned the above level recommendation of one full-time person to enable us to have two three-person crews, which would be beneficial for our workload. Stormwater management projects, I mentioned this. We have $40,000 built in to the budget, but we don't have anything over and above that. And sometime during the current fiscal year, we hopefully will have identified at least the beginning of the work that we need to do in order to comply with the stormwater mandates. But we need a funding source for that because it is going to be, the costs associated with that are going to be hefty. And you're all very familiar with the budget. There's no place to take up additional work. So we do have an opportunity to enact a stormwater utility fee, and that's something that we'll be talking about going forward. We have funding for our hazard tree program, which we just begun this fiscal year, $20,000 built into the budget. Facilities management, I mentioned the net metering credit agreement that we've not yet included. We don't have any town hall renovation included in this budget yet, so that's something that needs to be taken up. And then pavement management. What we do have in the budget is about $670,000 annually, and we have an accepted plan that calls for an annual expenditure of $1 million a year. The existing budget, we have Chapter 90, which comes from the state, in fiscal 16, just under $420,000. And then we have an operating budget appropriation of $250,000. Deferred maintenance on roads impacts the useful life of all of our vehicles and equipment, the school buses, and I mentioned this last year, the post office, because I every once in a while we'll get a complaint even from the post office that our roads are wearing on their vehicles. So last year we first talked about transferring the budgetary savings from retired non-exempt debt to fund pavement management projects as it becomes available. So the graph there that I hope you can see shows if we assume our Chapter 90 is going to be what it is in 16 going forward, $420,000. And we continue with our $250,000 because we already have that built into the budget, and it hasn't been built in too long. We just started appropriating money within the operating budget in fiscal 14, and we started at $107,000 and in pretty short order have increased that to $250,000, but we're still short of what we need. But if you were to take that retired debt service, and we can't do anything in fiscal 17, but in fiscal 18, the debt service being retired for non-exempt projects is $152,827. So if you were to take that, add it to our road budget, in fiscal 18, we'd be up to $822,000. If you did the same thing in 19, we'd be up to $952,000. And then by 2020, or if you want to go high or low, either fiscal 19 or fiscal 20, we're essentially spending $1 million a year. However, the problem with that is we're not there until fiscal 19 or fiscal 20, and every day Jack gets at least one call, maybe several, about roads, and we're also not addressing the other capital needs that we have. So that's something to consider with this plan. We could have done this sooner, but we, for the last 2 years, have done some short-term financing for capital projects. So that has increased a fire truck, the purchase of the Lane property, and the two pieces of DPW equipment that we're getting this year. But for those, we could have implemented this sooner. Obviously, those capital needs are needed as well. So the Board of Selectmen has identified funding for roads as one of their goals for fiscal 16. It's something that they've been working on. Hopefully, we'll have something to present on that within the next couple of months to be considered within this budget process. And then we're nearing the end. General administration. We're seeing an increase in general administration in fiscal 17. I think for the first time, probably in 2 years, we've been cutting from general administration through reorganization. I think that the reductions in the reorganization that we've made have been very good, but we're at the bottom, and we are projecting an increase in fiscal 17. The increase comes from contractual obligations. An increase in our annual audit, I'm projecting a 5% increase. I don't have a quote yet, but we have not had an increase in the cost of our annual audit in the time that I've been here, so in 8 years. So I'm expecting, I was put on notice that I should expect something, so I'm expecting something. We also have a requirement in fiscal 17 and in every other year to do our GASB 45 audit. This is to value our other post-employment benefits liability. So that's included. And we have an additional election in fiscal 17 that we have to account for. So debt service, this really is more for information. It's included in the forecast document. It shows what our total debt service is and all of the different funding sources for debt service. And then in the top graph, the bottom line, you can see the retiring, the debt service that's retiring. And then the I put a note in there under exempt debt. In fiscal 2023, we will be paying off, making the final debt service payments on the primary school and the public safety building, and then in 2025, the final debt service payments on the library. And then the bottom shows the impact on tax bill for the average assessed valuation just for exempt debt. So what's not included are the above level recommendations, which we've already reviewed. What's not included, I think, is a realistic expenditure for capital. We have included $600,000, and then beginning in fiscal 2020, $750,000. But the requests exceed $1 million, $1.5 million on an annual basis. So I don't think 600,000 is a realistic figure, but it's about what our budget has been for the last couple of years, and prior to that it was even less. What's not included, as I mentioned, is a town hall renovation or relocation. The building reuse committee is completing a study that was funded in fiscal 16 on, I called it phase one of the of this project. That phase one report is due at the end of this month. So that will give us some information on potentially where we're going with a town hall renovation or relocation. What's also not included is our OPEB liability, other post-employment benefits liability, and most of this is the liability that we have as an employer for retiree health insurance. So I put this graph in. It has the last several fiscal years. What the annual required contribution is, that comes out of our GASB 45 valuation versus the actual contributions made. And you can see that we're contributing about a third of what our annual liability is, leaving an unfunded liability of about two-thirds, or in fiscal 15, almost $2.4 million. So that's not included. That's something that we do need to talk about. I think the Finance Committee will recall, the Selectmen will recall, the one thing that I would like to do before we talk about this is the Board of Selectmen potentially has an opportunity to put together some local health insurance regulations. And we are meeting again, I think that's actually on next week's agenda, with our Labor Council to talk about that again. So I'd like to flesh out that first, have that available for our next valuation. And then I think we really need to talk about what we're going to do with this nut. You can see, if you look at this back in 2010, our unfunded liability was $3.34 million. The next year, it was reduced to about $2.8 million, and where we are now, about $2.3 million. It's not because we're contributing more. It's because our liability was reduced, and it was reduced for two reasons during this time period. The implementation of Section 19, when we did that, and that may have been implementing it in I would assume that's the first blip between 10 and 11. Section 19 is a local acceptance statute that requires, if it's adopted, it requires retirees who are eligible for Medicare to pick, to take Medicare as their primary health insurance. And the town then provides a Medicare supplement, the two together, which have an actuarial equivalent value of the plan that we offer active employees. So that significantly reduced our liability. So that was no money out of our pocket, that was just taking advantage of state law. And at this point, most communities have adopted Section 19, but 15 years ago, nobody had adopted Section 19. So that's something we can do. And that's why I would like to for the board to consider if there are any other things that we can do locally that can limit our liability, that we take those into consideration before and see what we have left to deal with as an unfunded liability. And then the other decreases, I think, really have to do with some plan design change. We've made some changes to our plans, and that's had a positive impact on current costs and future costs. So then, next steps. We certainly can talk about assumptions and revise assumptions if there's an interest in doing so. I will continue to firm up the revenue estimates as we get closer to the issuance of the fiscal 17 recommended budgets. The departments are getting ready to prepare their actual requests for fiscal 17. We'll receive our insurance renewals and other assessments beginning in February. And then we will begin review of the fiscal 17 budget process. Is that the, that is the last slide. So in your packet, there is a detailed list of all of the timetable, all of the different items to complete, and a proposed schedule of your budget review meetings. Mostly based on what you did last year, I made a couple of changes. I think really the one change I made is I moved DPW. Last year you had DPW and Monty Tech on the same night, so I separated them. I think that might have happened because of snowstorms, but that's a lot.
We did have a couple.
Yeah, that's a lot of material to take in one night, so I did make that adjustment. Annual town meeting is on May 7th. This year. Fiscal 16 is a leap year. I learned that as I was putting the calendar together. And we really did gain a week, I think, that when I...
It was pretty early last year.
Yeah.
And it's late this year, so...
So that's helpful. So you have... I didn't feel like I was cramming a whole lot in. I am suggesting that you meet with the Capital Planning Committee prior to the issuance of the fiscal 17 budget recommendation. I think you potentially have an opportunity to do that the end of January. I think I identified that. We did that, I don't know if we did that last year. Maybe we did that 2 years ago. I think that was helpful to pull the capital outside of the process. They should be ready. And then that makes it easier for you. And you really end up with an extra meeting, the last meeting in March. You certainly, you know, if you needed to have your public hearing, then you could rather than the week prior where I have it identified.
Right.
So
I think it makes sense to have some room in the schedule in case we do have a meeting cancellation. Due to inclement weather. Good.
So I'm happy to answer any questions you have.
I'd like to go back to a conversation about the debt service, the non-exempt debt, the impact on the capital plan, how that all unfolds. One of the things that we've been we've recognized is that even within the capital plan, there has to be a certain amount of borrowing for some of the larger ticket items. Is there room within the $750,000 that you've earmarked for capital for some of that to be debt expense? Or is that just the capital outlay?
Well, I mean, it's identified as a cash outlay for that year, but it certainly could be a combination of cash and short-term borrowing, you know, but we have to take that into consideration in the future.
Right, and I'm just thinking about some of the larger ticket items like replacing the ladder truck. I know we want to try and get a longer range view of some of the capital requirements, but that doesn't make them go away. It just tells us where they're going to fall in the schedule. And we'd all like to fully fund the pavement plan, but we have to find the right balance between freeing up funds for the pavement plan as well as taking care of the larger capital items that we need.
You know, I've been here for 8 years. When I started, I came from a community that I think had a very healthy capital plan, spent about $2.5 million a year on capital, a larger community, but really was very diligent in the capital plan. And it was a combination of cash outlay and short-term borrowing. And I proposed that at the time, doing something similar here, and it was not, people were not interested in that, and that's fine. It's a decision for the community to make. But what I heard were people weren't interested because we don't finance projects. We pay cash. And, you know, part of the reason we are where we are right now are, I think, from some unfortunate decisions that were made in terms of borrowing, because we absolutely did borrow for capital, and we borrowed a long time for some items. This fire truck that we purchased, 15 last fiscal year, will be paid off before the last fire truck that we purchased that we financed. We financed in the past studies that we've done. And so, you know, I don't think there's anything wrong with financing capital needs if it's done in a responsible manner. We all finance, or most of us, because when I use this example about financing a car, because I have to admit, aside from the first car I ever bought, which was the best car, I've had to finance every car that I've owned. And I made the mistake of saying, well, we all finance our car, and oh, no, we don't, apparently. We all finance our house, though, right? We all have a capital purchase, something that has a lifespan greater than a year, that we do a cost-benefit analysis, and it makes sense to finance it. So I don't think that we should just set aside financing because we don't want to enter into debt, because sometimes paying cash isn't, the expense of paying cash is not always worth it.
Well, certainly where the interest rates are today, there's an advantage sometimes in paying over time. But I don't think the interest rates are going to stay at all-time lows for very much longer.
The one thing I would mention is the capital projects over the last 2 years, the financing mechanism that we're using is called State House Notes. So I'm not sure. Some people probably are familiar with that. It is short-term financing that's available through the Department of Revenue. The legal requirements that are needed are very minimal. So the expense associated with financing in this manner is much less than you would find with a standard note issue. The interest rates are always very favorable, and if we're looking at financing something over 2, 3, or 4 years, this State House Note program is something that's very beneficial, and that's what we're doing with the 15 and 16 capital projects. I'm not sure I've ever seen that program in 20 years have an interest rate above 2%.
Other questions from the committee?
Just to clarify, the State House Note program would be for terms not to exceed, say, 3 or 4 years?
Yeah, I would say not to exceed 5 at max, and I want to say $2 million or less. So then we can't finance the school project. We finance that another way, through another state agency.
But that $2 million would be a net borrowing?
Yeah.
Okay, thanks. Yeah.
Speaking of the school, the borrowing for the school program, you mentioned that there's still $5 million or so yet to be borrowed.
Mm-hmm.
Would that be borrowed at the full 30-year term, or would it coincide with the term of the existing borrowing?
That is, I would say it would with the existing 30-year, so that would be slightly shorter than 30 years. Yeah.
Other questions from the committee? Questions from the public? Mr. Luck. Please. Introduce yourself, please, your address, you know the routine.
Yeah, I should. Carl Luck, 50 Sunset Lane. First, just another great job of pulling this together in a kickoff. And I know when there's something I don't understand, it's not good because it's probably important. So I just, on the making a case analysis here, for an example, I the school one is pretty clear. I believe I understand that fully. It's well done. I understand the words and the dollars. But then I kind of lose it on the making the case for just an example, public safety. The words I understand and what's trying to be accomplished, what I don't know is where this number comes from, the $48,000. I got to believe that's significant. I just can't figure out how that's determined and the significance of it.
So in the, if you go into the financial forecast document, we should be able to pull that right off of the summary page. Well, you know what, I don't have a column that shows the difference, but that $48,000 is the difference between the fiscal 17 forecast and the current year appropriation. So it's an increase in fiscal 17 of that amount.
Harry, would that be on your assumptions page, assumption number 3 under expenditures?
Oh, yes. Thank you for pointing that out. So, yeah, if you go to that one page, assumptions, expenditure assumptions number 3, there's a description of what the increases are, and the second column over fiscal 17 forecast, the increase is $48,913. I think the school is probably so clear because I want to make sure I get it right, so I put down as much as I can on my slide because I can't wing that like I can with some of the other departments.
Other questions from the public? Kerry, I'd just like to also offer my thanks and appreciation. This is a tremendous amount of work that you pull together every year. We, I think, get more and more informed as time goes on. This process gets tighter and tighter and better and better. And along that note, I'd also like to congratulate you and your staff for getting the tax rate certified in record time, I believe. That's a job well done.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank
you. So if there are no further questions or comments on the town manager's five-year forecast. I'll move on with the rest of our agenda. Do you have any other reports for us this evening?
No, I don't.
Okay, thank you. John, I believe we have minutes.
We do.
From some recent meetings.
Two meetings. The meeting of November 12th, then 4 days later, the meeting of the 16th, which was at the same time as the special town meeting. And as you know, I circulated an email to everyone with the draft copies of the minutes. I do have final copies here if they pass muster. I did have an issue with my inability to decipher what I had recorded or what the machine had recorded of Terry's report on the public safety. And it turns out, I think, Terry, that you did not meet with the police department, which is what I thought you had, right?
I hadn't. I had heard back from the fire chief, but not the police chief, in terms of, and it was the fire chief who said that there were nothing out of the ordinary.
Yeah. So that's the only feedback I got. Did anybody else have any feedback?
I did not. In fact, I know you had some questions as well about some of the votes that we took last spring.
That's correct.
And I think you've recorded our discussion accurately.
Wonderful. I was concerned about capturing the decisions last spring accurately, and I'm glad that in your that you confirmed that I have.
Yeah.
So
I will accept a motion. Let's make two separate motions. First, the minutes of November 12th.
I'll make a motion to accept the minutes of November 12th.
I'll second.
Any discussion? Those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? None. And on the minutes from November 16th.
And I'll make a motion to accept the minutes of November 16th.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Thank you. Any discussion? Those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? None. Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Under budget goals and opportunities, I did invite the superintendent and the school committee to join us for our meeting next week for an informal discussion of the budget, the school department budget, and they have accepted. Loxie and Greg are planning to attend. They also extended an invitation to the other members of the school committee. If they have a quorum, they will officially convene. It'll still be an informal workshop type meeting. So I'll save further discussion on that topic for next week. Do we have any committee or department updates? John?
But before we get to that, on the budget goals and opportunities, if I may, when I was listening to Sheriff Valera's presentation on the salary plan at the special town meeting, it occurred to me that I hadn't yet heard what the financial effect was of adopting that plan. So I started to look at the numbers a little bit. And it doesn't mean that there's not a financial effect, but I just wondered if I could, if you would mind us putting that on the next meeting agenda, at which time I will have a little more time to go over the numbers presented and see if there is in fact something that to me would raise a flag. And I'll And in addition, if there is, I would want to propose that we have some sort of liaison, suggest that we have some sort of liaison between this committee and the Personnel Committee for the duration of the personal planning process. But that'd be all contingent. But if you can fit it in next meeting, that would be fine. I don't think it would take more than 5 minutes, Mark.
Yeah. I think the short answer is that once that's adopted, that becomes part of the basis for the assumptions.
Yep.
Right?
Yep.
So I agree, it's important to understand what the implications of that might be.
It's interesting because I would have thought the financial impact would have come with the next phase.
That's what I was thinking but I don't know.
Okay.
And I just want to look at the numbers. I'll have something more concrete to offer next week when I've really poured over it a little more.
Okay.
That's fair.
Thanks.
Yep. Okay. Then on to committee updates.
DPW, I talked to Jack today about the Parks and Recreation Committee, and they are in a position to be a little more proactive relative to some of the management and maybe even collecting fees on the fields. Nothing has happened so far specifically, but at least I got the impression that Jack has at least initiated some discussion on that. So that is an improvement. So more later on.
Okay.
The PAC committee meets next Monday, and I will be in attendance there, so I'll be able to cover that. And I reckon that as a result of this kickoff meeting, the Capital Planning Committee will be meeting starting probably as early as next week, I suppose, or a week after.
Okay.
I don't have any reports.
Okay. Terry?
I went to the last library trustees meeting, and they were discussing this Saturday's 100th anniversary celebration over at the library. So I guess before heading over to the high school for their performance, you might want to take a peek at what the activities are for that. And actually, the other thing that they covered extensively was, and we reviewed the new website. It's available, that can be linked or can be accessed through the town site. But there's a lot of really, really good information on there. They're very pleased with how they've been doing with that. And that's really all I have to report. I have no other report.
Okay, thank you. Karen?
Let's see. Council on Aging meets next Tuesday, so I have nothing to report there. School committee had a televised meeting last night. They started going over their budget stuff. Superintendent Combs is going to have someone in her office get the documents posted. I think that's probably just the best way to update on that, is to just encourage everybody to take a look at those when they get a chance. And other than that, that's all.
Okay, thank you. The school building committee meets next week. So we've not met since my last report. The building reuse committee did meet last week. We got an interim status report from Charlie Hay at Tapay Associates on the review of the existing buildings and the feasibility plan for town offices. We have, I think, seven alternatives that he's looking at more closely in terms of what the potential cost might be. We looked at an evaluation matrix and the different criteria that we'll use to evaluate those options. He's putting together more detailed cost analysis as part of that, and we started working on a list of frequently asked questions as part of the public discussion of the study. We thought it would be appropriate to anticipate what questions we're likely to get and try to answer those and have those questions answered in advance. So we're working on that. We are on schedule to complete that study by the end of the calendar year. I don't remember the exact date when we next meet with Charlie, but it's before the end of the year. And that's all I have. Anyone see a need to discuss any of the ongoing business on the agenda?
No.
No.
Not at this time. Okay. Our next meeting...
You're pretty quick with that.
...is scheduled for December 10th, and we talked about that just a minute ago. We will have an informal budget workshop with the superintendent and school committee. I'll also add, John, at your suggestion, the budget impact of the salary plan so that we can talk about that. And I'm also very pleased that the town manager has already given us the budget calendar for the upcoming season. We can certainly plan our meetings accordingly. The December 10th meeting will be our last meeting of the calendar year, and then we'll resume our regular meeting schedule come the beginning of January. Town manager has proposed a meeting on January 28th. Let me just check the calendar real quick. Is that a regularly scheduled meeting, or is that a bonus meeting? It is the 4th, so that's a regularly scheduled meeting. We'll also meet on the 14th of January. Any other business for this evening? I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
I'll make the motion to adjourn.
Thank you.
Second.
Second.
Those in favor? Aye.
Aye.